Let's play a game. This bag has two cotton balls in it, one red and one blue. On each round of this game, you draw a ball from the bag without looking. If it's blue, the game finishes. You won. Good job. If it's red, then you put the ball back in the bag and add another red ball. Then you repeat. Okay, let's try it out. Round 1. Draw a ball from the bag. Ooh, you got the red ball. Unlucky. So put it back in the bag and add another red ball and shuffle them around. Now round 2. Draw a ball from the bag. Red again. That's okay. Put it back in the bag, add another red ball, and shuffle them around. Round 3. Draw a ball from the bag. Hey, you did it. It's the blue ball. That means the game finished after 3 rounds. The probability question is as follows. How many rounds does it take to draw the blue ball on average? This seems like a perfectly sensible question. We could ask a similar question like, how often should a coin land heads on average? And that has a clear answer of half the time. Can we figure out the expected value for the number of rounds that this game lasts? Maybe before we try analyzing it theoretically, we should get some real data on it. I don't have unlimited time and unlimited cotton balls, so I wrote a computer program to simulate this game of chance. Each time I run the program, it plays the game and spits out the number of rounds taken to draw the blue ball. Now, you'd think that by adding more and more balls to the bag, it might be possible to never get the blue ball, but the computer program always seems to terminate. Occasionally you get some longer games, like 11 rounds, but never infinite games. Okay, let's make the program run 1,000 times, and then average the number of rounds from those 1,000 games. The average comes out to around 5.5. Let's now make it run 10,000 games. Now the average is around 8.5. Let's try 100,000. Now the average is around 12. Is that enough to satisfy us? Do we stop here and say that the average number of rounds is 12? Just to be sure, let's try running 1,000,000 games. The program's taking a long time to run now, but it does eventually finish, and now the average is almost 15. What is happening? The average just keeps increasing. Remember, all of the games we've been running are independent. Every time we restart, we go back to a single red and blue cotton ball. Moreover, every game is finite. We always eventually draw the blue ball. But despite that, the expected value seems to grow without bound. Something weird is happening, so to make sure we're not making any mistakes, let's edit the program to stop adding red cotton balls. Now every round there's just one red ball and one blue ball, and we want to know on average how long it takes to get the blue ball. This is the same as repeatedly flipping a coin and asking how long it takes to get heads. Before we run this program, can we predict what the average will be? Well, there's two balls in the bag, so we might naively guess that it takes 2 draws on average to get the blue ball. As it turns out, this naive guess is correct. After running the game 100 times, the average is 2.08, after 10,000, it's 2.01, and after 1,000,000, it's 1.999. The average is getting closer and closer to 2. Okay, let's now turn that naive guess into something a bit more rigorous. How would we calculate, say for example, the expected value of a 6-sided die? Obviously, we would just take the average of the faces, which comes out to 3.5. But what we're really doing here is multiplying each outcome by its probability, then adding them all together. If the die were weighted, these probabilities would be different, but the calculation is still the same. So let's compute the expected value of our random game. If there's always just one red and one blue ball in the bag, how many draws does it take to get the blue ball? Well, we need to know the probability of each outcome. The probability of getting the blue ball on round 1 is 1/2. In order to get the blue ball on round 2, we need to get the red ball on round 1 and the blue ball on round 2, so that's 1/2 times 1/2, which is 1/4. In order to get the blue ball on round 3, we need to draw the red ball on the first 2 rounds and the blue ball on the third, so that's 1/2 times 1/2 times 1/2, or 1/8. Continuing this pattern, the probability of drawing the blue ball on round n is 1/2 to the n. Now we can calculate the expected value, take each outcome, multiply by its probability, and add them all together. I'm going to skip over the calculation, but you can slow down the video and look through each step if you want to. As expected, this infinite sum approaches 2. Okay, so now let's go back to the game at the start of the video. At the end of every round, we add another red ball to the bag. The probability of getting the blue ball on round 1 is still 1/2. In order to get the blue ball on round 2 though, we need to get the red ball on round 1 and the blue ball on round 2. But remember that on round 2 there are 3 balls in the bag, so that's a half times a third. In order to get the blue ball on round 3, we need to draw a red ball on the first 2 rounds and the blue ball on the third, so that's a half for round 1, 2/3 for round 2, and 1/4 for round 3. Let's do another to make sure we understand the pattern. The probability of drawing the blue ball on round 4 is a half for the red ball on round 1, times 2/3 for the red ball on round 2, times 3/4 for the red ball on round 3, times 1/5 for the blue ball on round 4. Okay, so our general formula looks something like this. Now, notice something cool about these products. 2 cancels with 2, 3 cancels with 3, and so on. That leaves the probability of drawing the blue ball on round n being just 1 over n times n plus 1. Great, now we can calculate our expected value, take each outcome and multiply it by its probability. We get some cancellation, and now we sum everything together, and this is the infinite sum we now have to compute. But there's a problem. This sum doesn't converge. There's multiple ways to show that this sum is infinite, but the most common is to construct a smaller sum and show that sum is infinite as well. Let's swap out 1 on 3 with 1 on 4, then swap out each of 5, 6, and 7 with 8, then do the same for the next few terms of 16, and so on. Clearly, this new sum that we've created is smaller, because the terms in the denominator are all bigger. But the 2/4 group together to give a half, the 4/8 group together to give a half, the 8/16 group to give 1/2, and so on down the line. So this sum is actually just a half plus a half plus a half on, and that's clearly infinite. And since the sum we started with is bigger than this new sum we've created, it must be infinite as well. So what this tells us is that the mean number of rounds doesn't converge to anything useful. The mean is meaningless. At this point you might say, come on Joe, we knew that was going to happen. If you keep adding red balls to the bag, then there's a chance you never draw the blue ball and keep drawing red balls forever, right? But that's the neat part, you don't. Every time you play this game, you will eventually draw the blue ball. What's the probability that you haven't drawn the blue ball before round n? It's 1/2 times 2 and 3 times 3 and 4 times 4 and 5, and so on up to n minus 1 over n. But we already saw that we can cancel all the middle terms, and this comes out to 1 over n. And as n increases, this probability gets arbitrarily close to 0. So in the limit, the probability that you never draw the blue ball is 0. I mean, you could argue that there's always some infinitesimal probability, but then you can make the same argument for the case where we're not adding red balls. I mean, if you keep flipping a coin until it lands heads, is there any chance that you'll just keep flipping the coin forever, always landing tails? I think it's reasonable in this circumstance to say no, and if you say no to this problem, then you have to say no to the other one. I will concede though that it may take a lot of draws to get the blue ball. We can modify our computer program to print out the longest game encountered, and after a million runs, the longest game took 4,606,259 draws. I do not have 4 million cotton balls. It is possible to make a game which has a non-zero probability of never ending. Let's instead add red balls until the number of balls in the bag is n plus 1 squared at the start of round n. So we start off with 4 balls, one of which is blue. Then on the next round we go up to 9 balls, one of which is blue. Then 16 balls, then 25, 36, and so on. The probability we draw only red balls up to round n is 3 and 4 times 8 and 9 times 15 and 16, and so on up to n squared minus 1 over n squared. If we do some very clever factorization, we can cancel some things and get a probability of n plus 1 over 2n. As n approaches infinity, this approaches 1/2. That means that in this game, there's a 50% chance that we just keep drawing red balls forever. But importantly, that's not the case for the game we started the video with. If we're only adding one red ball at a time, the game always finishes, although it might take a while. And yet it still has an infinite expected value. This is a weird edge case of probability, a fiddly counterexample that must be carefully dodged whenever you're working with random variables. There's a whole class of random variables that have this property, so how do we deal with them when we're organizing the theory behind randomness, where we describe everything in terms of expected value? The easiest thing to do is just ignore them and say these kinds of random variables are exceptional and we're just going to have to use a different theory to understand them. Normally, when you encounter these edge cases in mathematics, they're just quirks of definitions. For example, is 1 a prime or composite number? It doesn't really matter, because it depends on the way you define primeness and compositeness. Normally, you just exclude one from the categorization. But this is different. This is real. We wrote a real program to run this random variable and got real data on it. We can't exclude this. It exists whether we like it or not. Here's another example that crops up in physics, the Cauchy distribution. This is a bit different because the possible outputs of this random number generator are arbitrary real numbers rather than just whole numbers, but the effect is very similar. But wait, you might ask, this distribution is symmetric. Surely the expected value is right in the middle, at zero. Well, that's what you'd think, but if we take a million random samples from this distribution and average the results, we don't get zero. And if we repeat this, the results vary wildly. Basically, the center is zero, but the tails of the distribution are so heavy that the average keeps getting thrown off to either side. When things don't work out in mathematics, when problems crop up that can only be solved by imposing awkward restrictions, conveniently ignoring possibilities, or tediously working through exceptional cases, it can seem like the whole thing is a joke, like we're just making it up as we go along. But that's not the right way to approach it. That's not how a mathematician thinks. A mathematician looks at all these fiddly edges and sees new possibilities to explore, new problems to solve, new patterns to find. So to finish off, I'm going to leave a challenge problem relating to this weird game of chance. The expected value for the number of rounds is infinite, but what's the expected value for the number of digits in the number of rounds? This value turns out to be finite. See if you can find it. Then, if you think that problem's too easy, see if you can find another random game of chance, which also always terminates, for which the expected value for the number of digits in the number of rounds is also infinite. It is possible.